Meenakshi Rana extends a warm welcome to everyone. The psychosocial support cell of Meher Chand Mahajan DAV College for Women is grateful to all the participants for joining us. Friends, sleep is a vital, often neglected component of overall health and well-being. Today's workshop cum awareness program is in help people in developing correct knowledge and understanding of the importance of quality of sleep in for holistic well-being. In our begin with the program officially, I would like to introduce our college to the audience. Meher Chand Mahajan was established in the year 1968 by the DAV College Managing Committee, New Delhi, to commemorate the meritorious services of Meher Chand Mahajan, former Chief Justice of India, in the fields of law, administration, and education. The institution enjoys reputation in the sphere of higher education for women and has remained ahead of times with its innovative programs and infrastructure. The largest institution devoted to women education for the past more than half a century, with the strength of more than 5,300 girls, has been re-accredited with the strength of more than 5,300 girls. The institution has been re-accredited with in November 2016. We have been consistently ranked among the topmost colleges in the region by India Today, The Week, The Tribune surveys. We have won Punjab University Women's General Efficiency Sports Shields 39 times, and we have been accorded status by the Department of Biotechnology, Ministry of Science and Technology. The college has received the singular national honor, cleanest residential college in the country, in the National Swachh Sarvekshan Campus Rankings 2018 by the Ministry of Development, Government of India. It also won the All India Third Rank in Best Citizen-Led Initiatives in the Swachh Sarvekshan Housing and Urban Affairs, Government of India in 2019. Ministry of Skill and Entrepreneurship, Government of India, selected our college center for the Pradhan Mantri Kaushal Vikas Yojana. Surpassing all the previous records, our academic achievers secured 10 positions in Punjab University and semester examination 2018 and 19. The college's achievement under the exemplary leadership of Principal Dr. Nisha Bhargava, a renowned academician, researcher with impressive publications, where journal Energy and Building, member of Punjab University Senate, member of State Legal Services Authority, and a NAC assessor. Recently, the college has established the psychosocial support cell under the directions of Mahatma Gandhi National Council of Ministry of Human Resource Development, Government of India, to promote resilience among masses. Now, I would like to invite the co-convener, Psychosocial Support Cell of Meher Chand Mahajan DAV College for Women, to address the August gathering. Ma'am.
A very good afternoon, everyone. I welcome you all to this workshop, cum awareness program on the topic, quality of Sleep is an integral and fascinating, yet poorly understood part of all of our lives. We rely on sleep to relax and rejuvenate us and help us get ready to face the challenges of each new day. However, at we sip our coffees and teas to stop sleep from getting the better of us and help us be more productive. The COVID-19 has caused many of us to lose sleep, yet sleep problems might just be the actual pandemic that none of us has recognized or talked about. The psychosocial support cell of our college has been instrumental in providing to our students and the community during these difficult times. Under the able guidance of our worthy principal, Bhargava, this cell has become a tool in our arsenal during this fight with COVID-19 and its in keeping with its endeavors, we have with us Dr. Sandeep Grover, Professor, Department of Psychiatry, PD Chandigarh, to enlighten us on this interesting and vital topic. On behalf of our esteemed principal, Dr. the entire team of psychosocial support cell of Meherchand Mahajan DAV College for Women, Chandigarh, welcomes you, sir, a seasoned clinician, a prolific researcher who has made an indelible mark in the field of and mental health. I now invite Dr. Meenakshi Rana from the Department of Sociology to introduce our esteemed audience. Thank you.
Thank you so much, ma'am. I would like to take this opportunity to introduce our esteemed guest. Dr. Sandeep Grover, as ma'am said, is a professor, Department of Psychiatry, PGIMER, Chandigarh. Department of Psychiatry, Institute of Medical Education and Research, was established in 1963. It has been a WHO collaborating center for research in health. Faculty of the department have completed numerous funded projects supported by national and international agencies. Has more than 750 publications in peer-reviewed journals with more than 8,000 citations. He has authored more than 54 books. He has been the editor of Journal of Geriatric Mental Health, associate editor of Indian Journal of Psychiatry, editor Indian Journal of Psychology Medicine in 2018. Sir has been awarded thrice by ICMR for his research Tilak Vengoba Rao Award for the year 2007, Shakuntala Amilchand Award for the year 2013, and Vidya Sagar Award 2014. He has won multiple awards of Indian Psychiatric Society, Pune Psychiatric Association Award, first and second Rao Award, Marfetia Award, Indian Association of Social Psychiatry, G.C. Borel Award, B.B. Sethi Poster Award, an Indian Association for Geriatric Mental Health Award, Shweta Tiwari Award, to just name a few to his accomplishments. Also received the Young Psychiatrist Fellowship of the WPA 2008 and 2011. I just try to briefly, sir has the kind of personality we are going to enlighten with his words of wisdom. And sir, I have just tried to briefly introduce you. Delighted that a kind of personality we have with us, we are surely going to learn a lot. Thank you so much, sir.
Thank you, Dr. Meenakshi and Dr. Suman, for inviting me. Can I be allowed to share my screen?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Sure, Pratiksha, sir. Please stop sharing. Sir, before request for a group picture.
Sure, sure.
Thank you. I request all the participants here, kindly turn on your videos so that please turn on your cameras for a while. Just wait. Yes, with a broad smile. We see some very good faces there. And we are grateful for their presence. Thank you so much. Sir, you may start now. Thank you so much, sir.
Thank you.
I request the participants to take their videos off, please.
Somehow I'm not able to share the screen, just a minute.
Sir, I have given the permission for my end.
Yeah, I'm just trying to figure out that.
Yeah, it's okay, sir. Please take your time.
Present now, it is showing three options. Your entire screen, then it does not take me to the my back.
Sir, click on the entire screen.
Yeah.
Then there will be a pop-up.
Just a minute. Entire screen, yeah.
Yes. Sir, maybe there is a pop-up come that share screen.
Yeah.
Then share, sir, click on the share, that box inside the box.
Okay.
Yes, now you have started presenting. Now go to your PPT. You again.
Is it visible?
Started sharing, but now you have left. You may start it again, sharing the screen.
Just. Yeah, but it's.
Yes, sir, it started now. You can go to your PPT wherever it is in your laptop. Yes, we can see, sir. We can see.
You can see that?
Yes, sir. Yes.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you for inviting me and asking me to speak on sleep. This is something which we all of us are. So, when I was asked to speak on sleep, the few questions which came into my mind that when we are talking about quality of sleep, why are we discussing this? And these were the few questions which came to my mind, that why to discuss about sleep, and why let's understand that how much we need to sleep and how much people sleep less or why they sleep less and so forth. So with these questions, let me start see what we all understand. I'm just going to talk about the basics of sleep. I hope this will help us, but I can take up any questions any one of you have. So why to discuss about sleep? If we need to understand this question, we need to understand the basic fact that end at least one third of our life in sleeping. And if we look at an average person who lives for about 78, he spends more than 28 years in sleeping. That is about the one third of your life. And if you look at the whole things which we do in our life, 78 years of our life, we may just end up spending 9 years of our life in way we want to organize ourselves different than others. Otherwise, fixed. And sleep takes the maximum time, that is about one third of our life. That's why we need to understand the basics of sleep and why sleep is important. So the next question which comes to my mind at least is, why do we sleep? So, but we need to understand that sleep is plays a much more vital role than our diet or exercise in nurturing our, because the health is totally dependent on how much you sleep. Sometimes if you don't sleep, you will see that you are feeling weak, irritable, fatigued. So whatever diet you take, but if you're not able to sleep, whatever amount of exercise you do, if your sleep is not proper, still this will not work. The sleep helps the brain to prepare it for the next period. It provides the brain the required rest and prepared for the next period of wakefulness. If you look at the sleep, it allows you to conserve the body energy. As small children, they sleep more than the adults. So it has called the neural maturation or the brain growth, so that your brain develops properly and it continues to happen up to the adolescent. And if you don't, your mind stops functioning properly and you're not that creative as you may be if you are sleeping well. Further, sleep also helps us to, if we are going through, some people use sleep as a coping mechanism that they, if they have anything stress or facing, to avoid stress, they will prefer to sleep, and in both the situations, sleep is very, very useful. Further, sleep also helps us to regulate the emotions like irritability, anxiety, anger, depression. So if you are having emotional dysregulation, if you're not sleeping well, you will have more of emotional dysregulation. Further, if you sleep well, you're able to perform your work next day. So if, as a student, if you're not slept well in the night, you may not be able to focus in the class in the next day. And as a teacher, you may not be able to the class the next day. And that can apply to any kind of work situation. Further, sleep allows our body immune system to improve itself. We are talking so much about immunity and everything. So if you're not sleeping well during the COVID period, it itself can reduce your immunity. With sleep, the elimination of the so-called the free radicals, we all talk about antioxidants and so forth. So sleep itself acts as a very good antioxidant in that way, and this is the risk of heart disease and various mental disorders. So just trying to understand further, sleep also improves your hormonal balance. Sleep is an important factor which helps the growth hormone to function properly or get secreted properly, and also improve your memory and your cardiovascular health. So with this background, let's try to understand how much to sleep, which everybody has in mind, and we all keep on wondering about it. So we need to understand that this minimum amount of or the average required varies with different age. As the person grows older, the requirement for sleep reduces, but in general, a sleep of, let's say, 7 to 8 hours or maybe 7 to 9 hours is something which is sufficient for the adult. Sleeping less than will be detrimental, but for an elderly, maybe sleeping for about 6 hours may be enough. So this is something which we need to understand when we are talking about sleep, trying to answer the question, how much a person should sleep. If we look at the newborn or the children, they may be sleeping for 12 to 15 hours. That is the minimum requirement for them. Mothers are often worried, my child is sleeping too much. It's not that. If he's sleeping too much, or if he's sleeping what is required for his age, actually it will help his growth, in his mood, and his improvement in terms of his functioning. So in this background, let's try to understand less and why do people sleep less, because this is again important. So as clinician, when we look at this, about 50% of the clinicians will report some sleep disturbance. So especially if they are coming to the psychiatric practice, about some amount of sleep disturbance. And in general population, about 30% of people have some kind of sleep disruption, but they will have about 10% of people will have sleep problems that is leading to their dysfunction. So this is the amount of problem which we have in the society, and every one person is suffering from some kind of insomnia or sleep disturbance, and which can manifest either in the form of difficulty in falling asleep or difficulty in returning to sleep after waking, difficulty in staying asleep for the required duration. And why do people sleep less in today's world? The main reason for sleeping less is the poor sleep habits that we all are so used to, the gadgets that we all are joining now with the gadgets to each other. Used to it that it has become so much important in our life that we cannot live with it, live without it. And before we retire, most of us will do, last thing which we do is check our mobile or the gadget we have, and as if we are going to miss out on something before we go. So too much of exposure of the media. Again, we have TVs in our bedroom, we have computers all around. So all this sleep habits. Further, in the COVID times, that our routine has been disturbed, so that has also contributed to the poor sleep habits, which can be due to exam, any kind of performance, or any day-to-day hassles. In today's in the current situation, many people are facing financial issues, so responsible for stress, and that can again lead to sleep disruption. Of course, some of the medication can disrupt somebody's sleep. The other factor, which for the people who introduce the talk, that use of substances, something like caffeine, nicotine, or alcohol, can disrupt our sleep. Or meal at the wrong time can disrupt somebody's sleep. Of course, when you are traveling or something, your sleep may get disrupted. Now, this is the most important thing to understand: consequences of poor sleep. So when you are sleeping poorly, what you're going to have is some kind of sleep deprivation symptoms in the form of you're not able to concentrate in your work, you're not able to sleep well, your mood keeps on fluctuating, you keep on forgetting things, and you may have symptoms of, so let's say, fearfulness, paranoia, or sometimes occasionally people may start having hallucination. On this account, the lack of sleep can also lead to disruption in the immune system, your appetite, and then can disrupt so-called the skin changes, can also disrupt your cardiac health and increase your risk of cancer. If you're sleeping less long duration of time, you may be at a risk, higher risk of developing a cancer. So if just we want to understand 10 effects of deprivation on mind and body, we need to understand that the two things the sleep basically disrupts mainly is your brain and your heart. So in the, you will have depression and anxiety, forgetfulness, other brain functions dysfunction, and any in terms of cardiac issues, you can have hypertension, heart attack, and stroke. And additionally, you will end up gaining weight, contributes to the cardiac problems. You can develop diabetes mellitus, and your immune system can get disrupted, which can again predispose you to various infections. Of course, at the end, it can also disrupt a person's fertility if you're not sleeping well. So the other important question asked, or which often people want to understand, when to sleep, because this is the most important thing which we need to understand, that many times people will come, how many hours you are sleep? 9 hours, maybe 10 hours, but the sleep time may be, which may be incorrect and which will lead to the problem. So we need to understand sleeping time should align with the natural circadian rhythm of the body. This is why, according to the natural circadian rhythm, usually the sleeping time should be very close to the 10 and the waking time should be very close to 6 a.m. So how is our circadian rhythm working? That it basically is like an orchestra working inside our various, in which various hormones play an important role in inducing sleep. And one of the important hormones there is a melatonin, which secretion of in the body at the peak will start somewhere close to the 9 p.m. And accordingly, we need to start going to sleep somewhere close to this time. Is the right time to go to bed, and gradually as the melatonin secretion will keep on decreasing, and then the lowest melatonin levels are seen early in the morning, that's about 7:30 a.m. So you are supposed to sleep maybe maximum by that time you should be awake. And why this is important, we need to understand this, that this so-called circadian rhythm in our body, which is monitored by different functions and the brain areas, it basically monitors our whole body. Like in the morning, if you are waking up, the best waking time is 9 a.m. Then your mind is most alert between 9 a.m. to 12 a.m. And then in the afternoon, we all feel slightly, we feel like resting for some time. Then between 3 to 6 p.m. is the right time to do some kind of exercise. And then 9 p.m. this is where you need to avoid taking very heavy meals, and about 9 to 12 at night is the best time to go to sleep, because between 12 to 3:30 maybe body is totally shut down, and that's the time you need to give body the rest which it requires. And then in the morning, that you need to wake up between the required timings. Now, how to sleep is again an important issue to understand. We all have our own postures of sleeping. We all take different positions in how we sleep, and does that matter is a question which everybody have in their mind. So the best position which is said is to sleep in a left lateral position between the legs, like which is known as a fetal position with slightly extension of the legs. Because if you sleep on your back, problems, if you can see that it can benefit your skin in some way. If you're sleeping on your back, if you're sleeping on the side, heartburns, that is the left lateral position, the heartburns, it will help your brain health, also be improve your blood flow and reduces your constipation. But if you're tummy, you will have more of anxiety, you will have some kind of spinal problems, have pressure on the back, it would put a lot of pressure on the back and the neck, stiffness. So that's why it is usually recommended that you sleep in the left lateral position, so that it will benefit your GI system, your brain, also your spine, and especially in pregnancy, again, this position is very, very helpful in improving the blood circulation. The other important aspect improves your immune functions by improving the lymphatic drainage. Now, with this background, let's try to understand how has COVID-19 impacted sleep. So we all are going through this kind of irregular schedule. Earlier we had a fixed time, this time to get up, go to the college or come to your work and do some, go back to your home at particular time, then have a fixed time at to sleep because you know what next morning I have to get up and go back. But now that restriction is gone. You don't have to get ready to also attend an online class maybe, or to make an online class presentation. You can just brush and start taking the class or attending the lecture. So the schedule has gone haywire. Then, as I said, we are using excess of, people are becoming dependent on screen media because of the time. That is one, that they don't have anything else to do. They are spending much more time with the so much access to the social media and everything. It further is increasing the screen time, and other aspects which are coming contributing to increased sleep time is, then we do not have any fixed time for our meals also now, that we can take it that we are getting up late, so the breakfast is close to the lunch time, after evening time, and so everything is getting postponed. So if you are taking heavy meals later, again it is disrupting your sleep. Enclosed during the COVID, so exercise has reduced, although some people are doing cycling or doing some kind of walk or going to park, but it's still not the same as it was. And for some people, the stress has increased in the form of thinking about earnings, taking care of the home, for mother, the children, they have to take care of the husband. Earlier, the school were open, the children would go to school. Now the mothers have to supervise the children throughout the day. They have to also supervise the small children, so the work for mother has increased. For some people, those who are working very regularly, their college or their workplace has stopped work functioning, be experiencing some amount of decrease in stress, but in general it is stress told that the stress has increased. Besides the work, the stress has been also been contributed by the action, and also to that you are not able to meet your friends, not able to meet your colleagues, not able to do things which you want to do. So that is again contributing to increase in the stress. So all this is leading to irregular sleep timings. And what is the data suggesting? That 20% of the adults are reporting some kind of sleep problem since the beginning of the COVID-19 pandemic. What is required? What is the most important thing when we cannot sleep in the prevailing times? What changes which we need to do? What I'll first discuss what not to do to get good sleep. The important thing is that, as I've said, that cut down the non-sleeping time in the bed. That bed should only be used for sleeping or maybe having the sexual gratification. Otherwise, eating food or using the screen media, all this should be avoided on the bed, or maybe reading a book also by lying down, all this should be avoided. should be only used, should be restricted to these two activities, either that is the sleep and the sexual gratification. Other than that, all activities should be appropriate place, like sitting on a table and chair rather than lying on the bed. Then the important thing to understand, you should not worry if that I'm not able to sleep and you're worrying about I'm not getting sleep. I think that worries will actually further complicate the matter that you will not be able to. The next in the line that what do not worry about how about or the focus hours you are sleeping, because many people worry that I am sleeping for 2 hours, 4 hours, 5 hours. That should not be the major concern. It should be the quality of sleep which matters, not the hours. Hours do matter if you are sleeping at the appropriate time and everything. A minimum duration has to be there, but at the same time, you occupied that I am sleeping for less hour is something which we need to get rid of. Then we should, the best thing to determine whether or not is that how much you are alert during the daytime and how much you are able to function during the daytime. If this is fine, it indicates that you are, and that if you are doing well and you, this or if this is improving, you can understand that you are sleeping well. Next is that if you are not able to sleep, please do not keep on watching the clock. That people have checking their clock, maybe the wristwatch or the phone, other things, that what is the time now? Why have not been able to sleep? So that those distractors which actually disrupt your sleep. And the other thing is many people try to put a wall clock in the bedroom or the wall reflection, you can see the time, all the lights are off. That kind of wall clocks should be avoided in the bedroom, or preferably any kind of watch in the bedroom should be. Because if it is not available, there are more chances that you are not going to look through every time. And if at all in between you wake up and you are not able to fall asleep again, that is where you should not be looking at the clock. Just roll over and give yourself some time that, and you'll be able to go back to sleep. And avoid taking heavy meals close to the sleep time. That usually it is advisable that if you want to take heavy meals, the breakfast, lunch, should choose one of them to take a heavy meal, but usually it says that heavy breakfast is better rather than having a heavy dinner. Be avoided. The dinner should never be a heavy dinner, because that leads to a lot of complications with your sleep. Similarly, avoid taking alcohol, nicotine, especially in the evening hours, especially after the dinner time, because it will again disrupt your. Then avoid caffeine, chocolates, and the late afternoon, especially after the so-called late afternoon, the evening hours, because anything after, let's say, about 3 p.m. is, if you're taking too much of coffee, chocolates, ideally avoid. So you need to understand that you should be avoid. If you want to take this, you're fond of all this, prefer to take them in the early half of the day rather than evening hours of the day. Then is the issue of daytime naps. If you want to take a daytime, you should avoid taking long daytime naps. And people who already have insomnia should avoid taking daytime naps. And what does the data suggest? How long? The data suggests that daytime naps of about 10 to 20 minutes are actually considered the ideal power naps. So you should not be taking naps longer than this. Because if you sleep for much longer time, or then, or you're sleeping for 30 minutes or 60 minutes, actually your whole sleep completed. So you wake up in between tired actually. So you, if you want to take a power nap, it should be very short power nap. Summarizing that, watching TV till the late night, long naps during the daytime, killing too much of time on the online, different bedtime at each night that you are not following a particular schedule, drinking too much of tea, coffee, and waiting to fall asleep before you, and being on your phone for long, or staying in the bed when you are unable to sleep, and overthinking about what is going to happen tomorrow, are the cause do, and that is where they're not able to have good quality sleep. If you look at the data which comes from India, that 32, if you look, 25% people who are planning to go to sleep keep on watching shows on TV or the smartphones. 22% about the future, 90% keep on working in bed on the laptops, and 90% keeps on scrolling on the screen media. So that is where we can understand. And that is why about 1/3 of us always keep on feeling tired, and we keep on going to the doctor that I'm having this or that problem, but they're not sleeping well. And about 1/6 believe that they have some kind of insomnia, and 80% feel sleepy at their work in a week. And about 1/2 of them are suffering from some kind of back problem. So you can understand all these are arising or the genesis for sleep. Now, what to do to get good quality sleep? Let's understand this. So snacks close to the bedtime will actually help to sustain sleep. So if you want to have something in the evening hours, it should be just a light snacks, nothing like a heavy meal. And you should have a regular exercise program in the morning and the afternoon or the evening hours to promote your sleep. In the right time, it is going to help you. So if you want to exercise, don't delay it also too much. Don't try to exercise too late. Maybe the best time to exercise is somewhere 3 to 6, maybe about 7 p.m. After that, actually, it is not very much helpful. It may actually disrupt your sleep. Then, just you need to feel refreshed in the daytime. Do not try to oversleep or do not try to undersleep. That if you're sleeping too much, good. Or if you're trying to sleep less, that's also not good. And always try to expose yourself to bright light at the right time, especially in the morning, the late hours, late afternoon hours, so that it will again help you to synchronize your circadian rhythm with the environment. Because many people in sunlight, their circadian rhythm goes haywire, or it's not synchronized with the environmental rhythm, and that is why they keep on facing the sleep problems. Get up at the same time all the 7 days a week. We all have this habit of sleeping till late in the weekend, and then we try to compensate other 6 days. That is not very good. You should always have a fixed time to sleep for all the 7 days in the week, and we also need to go to bed at the same time each night. Helps you to maintain your sleep schedule. Then, if you want to worry about something, or something is going in your mind, it's better that you try to set aside some time in the evening, at least an hour before your bedtime, to deal with your problems of life, and maybe write down how you want to cope, how you want to so-called deal with them, so that once you're going to your bed, at least you have already done with this exercise. Worried about all this, because any kind of worry can disrupt your sleep. The other important issue is of the adjustment of the bed. What is ideally said, the darker it is, better it is, but many people prefer different kind of situations. But in general, those who are facing insomnia, you that try to sleep in a dark room. Then the use of the mattress, because that is again something which we often don't importance to when we are talking about sleep. If you sleep on a mattress which is too soft, it is going to sag, and your back is not going to get supported. Keep on having some kind of back problems, and if it's too firm, again it may be a problem. So it is better that the medium soft to medium mattress is something which you should choose, so that takes the shape of your body, supports your body in the right way, so that you are able to sleep well and also feel day. Then avoid any kind of blue lights at least half an hour before you go to sleep. Then set temperature again at close to about 65 degrees Fahrenheit, and rather than having too cold a room and then covering yourself with blanket and everything. I've already said, stance and take care of the mattress which you are using, and always do exercise. Then in terms of the bedroom environment, I've already. But if you get up in between at night to go to the washroom, use minimum light at that time, try to avoid light at that time, and to make your bedroom more comfortable, use some kind of perfumes and other things which will be make the environment of the room sleep. And if you have a partner who keeps on snoring or picking here and there, it's better to either shift out of the room or shift him or her out of the room. And if you cannot sleep and feel yourself that you are getting frustrated as you remain in the bed, it's always better to get up and do something relaxing. You may go to other room, sit down, read a paper, read a book, or do something, but avoid any kind of sleep. Come back to the bed till you are not feeling sleepy. So, as I've said, that you this is the summary of everything. Not reading for you here. Then fix, if you are facing some kind of insomnia and you're having difficulty in other way, the first thing to do is fix the timing of getting up, irrespective of the time you're going to bed. That means basically if you're sleeping at 2 p.m. also, sorry, 2 night also, still, if you want to get up at fixed time, let's say 6 a.m., you get up at 6 a.m. You sleep at 10 p.m. at night, still get up at 6 a.m. Or you're sleeping at 4 a.m., still get up at 6 a.m. That will help you to synchronize your clock with the body clock with the environmental clock, and gradually you will start having normal sleep. Once you have synchronized that, maybe try to fix the time to go to bed, avoid daytime naps, and if still it's not helping you, consult a psychiatrist. So 5 ways which you can do to improve your sleep is get up at the same time of the day, get 15 to 20 minutes of sunlight every day, do relaxing at bed, and use bed only for sleep and sex, and avoid screen light, caffeine, alcohol before going to bed. This is what I would say, that sleeping is my favorite pastime, and whenever I get time, I go to sleep. Thank you.
Thank you so much, sir, for the brilliant presentation. You have almost talked about all the aspects. I have few questions, so if you give the permission, I can read out the questions.
Sure.
Sir, the first question is, I have dreams. I dream a lot.
Yeah.
And feel restless in the morning.
Yeah. See, dreams could be due to the various reasons. One is the if you're not sleeping in the proper time, or you're not let's say that you have a lot of worries which are going in your day-to-day life, all those can manifest as increased so-called sleep. The other factor which can contribute to things is the medications you may be taking. So we need to evaluate various aspects before we consider why some dreams which are disruptive. So having normal kind of dreams once in a while is fine. Anybody can have dreams, is always not bad. But if the dreams are of a particular quality and you're that is disrupting your sleep in some way, and that's why next day you're not feeling fresh, I think you get yourself evaluated.
Yes, sir. So the next question is, students are asking, they are having a lot of dreams. They actually have all the time. But they are asking, this is affecting their sleep, and they try to study in the night time and has affected their sleep pattern. How they should help themselves in this?
See, basically what we do is we disrupt our sleep pattern knowingly. We think that at night I can sleep better, at night I can concentrate better, at night there'll be less disruption. All these are myths. If you want to study, you have access to library, you can sit in your room and study. Prefer to study during the day and synchronize your sleep with your so-called the environmental sleep pattern and the body sleep pattern should be synchronous. If during the odd hours, it actually affects your health, and next day you'll not feel fresh. So it is always better that studying till late night. I've said that 10 p.m., maybe maximum you go up to 11 p.m. be very good.
Yes, sir. Sir, some people are asking that in case they are compelled to work in night, maybe due to their shifting of work, so what they can eat during the night hours if they feel hungry, and they should avoid caffeine or not, like in the form of.
See, if you are on a regular so-called night shift duty, then your biological clock or the body clock will get synchronized in the reverse direction. Then for you, the actual the environmental day becomes night. So once you have done your night duty, you have worked in the night, then you should avoid any kind of too much of light and preferably go to the room, sleep in the dark room. So from that point of view, at night, then the whatever you want to take in terms of caffeine, other thing. But again, remember that you're finishing your shift at the 8 in the morning, you want to go back and sleep at, let's say, to avoid, take that gap into mind, maybe after 12 at midnight, you should avoid coffee and other things.
Sir, another question is if I'm having poor sleep, is that something to do with my cognitive functioning?
Yeah, I've already said that if you are not sleeping well, it is going to hamper your memory and attention concentration, and so in long run it can disturb your
yes sir. So another question is, I have a problem of overthinking on the at the bedtime. How,
as I said, that if you have this habit of overthinking, set aside an hour's time for yourself before you sleep time, so that you are able to give that time to so-called overthink. Think about what are the issues which are there in your life, how you want to handle the same thing after going to bed. Once you go to bed and start overthinking, it will increase your anxiety, and as your anxiety will increase, you will not be always better. If you have a habit of overthinking, planning, doing things, do that before you go to bed.
Yes, sir. Pratiksha, from the YouTube, I do have 5 questions more here.
Yes, ma'am, there are 2 questions.
Please ask. I am muting myself now. Please ask.
Good evening, sir. There is one question from the participant. Morning. And she faces too many dreams during her sleep time.
Yeah. Yeah. I think this is a repeat of the question. That if it's not just the issue of dreams and tiredness, it may actually involve sleeping in, maybe a lot of stress going in the life, or there may be other issues, whether the person is on any kind of medication or not, is the person taking any kind of substances or not. So detailed evaluation before I can say what is to be done. But what I will simply say, that try to sleep at the right time and follow the issues which I've alluded in my talk. If that still does not help, then you may consult a psychiatrist.
One more question. It says that the girl is unable to wake up on her own, and she is not able to set her biological alarm. And one more person is saying that they feel curious at night and they don't know how to sleep. They can't go back to sleep.
Yeah. See, again, that somebody is not able to wake up in the time in the morning is something which is uncommon. It can happen with everybody. It's a basic issue of developing a habit. If you are, see, when we all have a habit, maybe, but if any day you want to travel somewhere, you will see that you want to catch a train in the morning 5 o'clock, you are awake at 3:30 itself. So it's a motivation which determines whether you want to wake up, whether you want to make a habit for yourself or not. That is the most important thing. But if you require some, it is fine. What was the second question? Can you just repeat that? Just
yes, sir. Sir, it says that the girl is anxious or curious during her nighttime, and she is unable to sleep with them.
Yeah, as I said, that basically what happens, that people have, again, when I don't know what this question means, but let me clarify that many people have this habit of, once they get up in the night, washroom, The other thing which they will do is check their mobile for any kind of messages. That is a curiosity. Now, once you start expose yourself to light, you start checking your messages and you don't know how much time you spend, 5 minutes, 10 minutes. It is all that exposure to light actually disrupts your sleep pattern. Then you're not able to sleep, and that is what you feel you have been curious. Best thing to do is not to touch any kind of screen once you get up in the mid. Just use the washroom and again go and lie down and give yourself a few minutes, you'll fall asleep.
So that he has just recovered from COVID-19 last week, and he is having sleep disruptions frequently.
Yeah.
How he can sleep sound sleep? Yes.
As I said, the basic facts which I have told that applies to post-COVID situation also, but she has gone through COVID, we may like to evaluate him or her to see whether he has any kind of depression, anxiety, any kind of PTSD features, or what kind of medication he is on, is that those disrupting his sleep. So a detailed evaluation is required, but again that would be required if you follow whatever and still you are not able to fall asleep. If you are able to follow all this or some of these and you are able to fall asleep, then it's fine.
So one question is regarding hallucination. She is saying that she has hallucination regarding someone is hitting her, or throwing, like, and she gets scared while sleeping and wake up.
Yeah. Okay. Again, I'm saying indicator of so-called sleeping for lesser duration, or it could be an indicator of some kind of mental illness, or it could be an indication of some kind of stress going on in his or her life. So the first thing to focus is sleep for the adequate duration and follow the advice I've said. If that does not help, may require.
Sir, many times we were suggested that listening to good music, people are also asking in the chat, helps making you sleep, like listening to music.
See, anything which suits you in your environment, soothing music, low volume can help to sleep. But if you're listening to too loud a music, itself can act as alerting and can disrupt your sleep patterns. Music may be useful, not that loud music will be of benefit.
Sir, one person is mentioned that she severe headache frequently after waking up in the morning. However, she has completed her cycle of 8 hours of sleep. So
again, what I'm just trying to repeat the thing. Let's see, sleep, if your sleep hours, if you say I was sleeping for 8 hours, I just want to first understand what is the sleep timings. If you're sleeping for abnormal timings and then you're still saying 8 hours, that me. So what I want to understand, what is the time of you go to bed? What time do you get up? That's the first evaluation which I like to get up, get more information about. What kind of situation he or she is in, what kind of stress he or she is facing, what kind of medication he or she is taking. So then, level of evaluations.
And sir, two last questions. One is walking during the sleep.
Yeah. So the walking during the sleep is a independent illness which requires, and there are different causes for it and which requires proper psychiatric treatment. So that is not counted, that we need to understand. You get up to go to washroom, it's not walking in sleep. You are aware. Walking in sleep is slightly different, that you walk out, what you do and you don't remember anything what happened. That's a very different kind of a scenario. Now, the snoring, again, snoring, what we need to understand, reason of snoring is either sleeping in the wrong posture or obesity. So if you want to avoid some kind of snoring, under position for you to sleep and reduce your body weight. But if still it is not helping or the snoring is too much, that is disrupting the thing is such that it itself wakes you up at night, means you are suffering from something like obstructive sleep apnea, and for which you require treatment. some kind of BiPAP support and other things.
So what can be the probable reasons for daytime sleepiness? So for having tea or coffee to avoid that daytime sleepiness?
See, daytime sleepiness, lack of alertness could be due to different sleeping properly at night, or your sleep duration is less, or if you're sleeping at the wrong time, you will have daytime drowsiness. Address the basic things. Till you don't address the basic things, we should not be doing each small fraction of the issue to be addressed. Being drowsy during the daytime, so let me go and take a cup of coffee or tea. That may help you that moment, but in long run, that is not going to help until unless you correct your sleep pattern. Develop as a new habit that every day, every night you're sleeping in the wrong way, and in the daytime you just keep on taking tea, coffee to keep yourself awake. It is not going to help.
So there is one girl who is asking that her grandparents are not able to sleep properly in the night, and they used to sleep for a less duration, only for, she has mentioned, 3 hours. So how she can improve their sleep quality?
Yeah.
And they are, sir, plus 70.
Yeah, as I said, that compared to sleep for lesser duration, a sleep duration about 6 hours or let's say 5 hours is still okay. If they're sleeping, the first thing which again I would like to understand, as I said in my talk, it's not the duration which is only important, performing the next day. Are they happy with their sleep duration? Are they able to perform everything normally? Then nothing to be done. Okay, but they are themselves distressed that they're not sleeping well, it is hampering their functioning in daytime, they're not able to do things properly, then they require a proper consultation, further evaluation. Physical illnesses for which they may be on many various medications, that may be contributing to disruption of sleep. So that again requires evaluation.
Next question here is taking sleeping pills. Is it a normal thing we can have usually, or we should avoid taking sleeping pills?
Sleeping pills needs to be avoided. That is especially if you want to take some kind of sleeping pills continuously for weeks to months together. Avoid taking sleeping pills if your sleep has been disrupted once in a while. It's still okay. That you had a night somewhere and you have missed your sleep, or there was some stress or something that has led to disruption of your sleep, maybe once in a while is okay. But taking it continuously, weeks together, months together, is not required or not recommended.
Yes. Thank you, sir. Do we have any other questions? Because I have finished all the questions from the Google Meet. Pratiksha, do we have any question from the YouTube live streaming?
Ma'am, they are all repeated ones.
Okay. Sir has already talked about most of the things. One repeated question is, of cold coffee to get rid of that daytime sleepiness.
And that's what I've said. I've already answered that question, that correct your sleep habits. That is the most important thing. Once you have done that, we all have some need for coffee at some time of the day. That is not related to the sleep. But if you're feeling so drowsy and you just always require a cup of tea or coffee to, then you require evaluation, or that requires you to correct your sleep pattern.
Thank you so much, sir. Wonderful explanation. However, many times we avoid many issues related to sleep, but it is a vital component and it is related. I have learned from your presentation, it is not something that is coming naturally to you, that it's going to restore its quality on its own. You also, thank you so much, sir, for the wonderful session. On behalf of Principal Dr. Nisha Bhargava, I would like to thank you. You have spared your valuable time in these challenging times and share your words of wisdom for us. So thank you so much, sir. With the beginning for the first of all, I would like to thank Dr. Sadeep Grover ji for sparing his valuable time. Dr. Nisha Bhargava, Principal Ma'am, you have the opportunity and allow us to organize such a relevant session for the audience. Thank you so much, ma'am. Thank you, Suman Mahajan, ma'am, and Vandana for joining us for the day, and all the technical team, Dr. Preeti Gambhir, Ashish sir, thank you so much for your value. And we have come to the conclusion of a very enlightening session. Thank you so much. Take care, all of you. God bless. Thank you so much. Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Thank you for your wonderful
thank you.
Session.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, Suman ma'am, for being there.
Thank you, Meenakshi. Thank you so wonderfully. It was thank you, really ma'am. Informative session.
Yes, ma'am.
Thank you. Yeah, congratulations, Meenakshi. It was very informative lecture. Very informative.
Thank you so much for the support. It's just because of the support of principal ma'am and senior faculty members like you that help us doing these kind of activities. So much, ma'am.
Thank you.
Dear participants, feedback form we have already shared in the chat box. Pratiksha, can you share it again for some? Yes, please, you all may leave if you have filled the feedback form. Kindly note, it won't be, I won't be sending you through the so kindly fill here only. If you have filled, then you may leave, please. Thank you so much for joining us. Thank you.